Well, Glenn, I just couldn't conceive of a more suitable opening to a major series dealing with the keyboard music of Bach than the Art of Fugue that you just played. However, I think that we should probably address the issue that most people will probably raise about this series, that you're playing all of this music on an instrument for which it was not, in fact, written.
Yeah, I think we should attack that one head on, Bruno. I'm not inclined to be defensive about it, I must say. I'm not inclined to apologize too much. I really think, frankly, that the piano does offer a great many resources which are entirely appropriate vis-a-vis the music of Bach, and that it also offers some that are entirely inappropriate. So it really becomes a question of, I was going to say, using those things that enhance the music, but that's a bad word, of using those things or adopting those things which really work within the parameters that the music itself observes. I think that's the safer way of putting it, probably.
Well, of course, there are two really contrasting arguments which are put forth very frequently. One is that if Bach had had a piano, he would certainly have used a piano.
I'm sure he would have. He was a very practical man in most ways, as we know. And a few years before he died, when he saw a, what was it called, a Silbermann piano at Frederick the Great's court when he visited there, he seems to have had very nice things to say about it, so he probably would have used it. But I think it's not a terribly relevant argument one way or the other, because whatever he saw at Frederick's court was such a totally different beast from what we know today, you know, that it doesn't really stand comparison.
Okay, but the other argument, of course, is that he really didn't know the piano, notwithstanding his visit to Frederick's court, and that he didn't think in terms of its capabilities, that he couldn't have imagined the kind of instrument that it would become 2 centuries later, and that consequently, whenever one does play this music on something other than the instruments that he knew, you know, the harpsichord or the clavichord, one is in some way, I would say, violating the music, is not allowing to declare itself, to speak within the limits of the sonority that Bach had imagined.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, yeah, that is the other argument. I think that's where the proposition goes off the rails, if I may say so, Bruno, because if one really believes that, then it surely follows that one also believes that Bach, you know, cared deeply about the specifics of sonority and of timbre as an element of composition. That in effect he was almost a slave to the instruments which he wrote, and I just don't think that's the way it was with Bach at all. There are just far, far too many examples to the contrary, but I guess for those examples I'm going to need the piano.
What do you have in mind? Do you have the violin concertos?
Oh,
the...
yes. Da, da, da. Sure, what he writes for the violin is E major. He turns right around and does for the keyboard in D major. And the fact that these same movements from these concertos, some of them anyway, turn up in the cantatas and are played on the organ, almost note for note. There are just countless examples of that sort of thing. And I doubt very much that if he had known the piano, he would have spent very much time worrying about whether it violated some specific sonorous intention of the music. Which does not mean, on the other hand, that he would have adapted himself to the piano or the keyboard, that he would have ever turned himself into an 18th century Alexander Scriabin or anything like that. You know, he was just too much involved with questions of structure to even worry about things like that. And the best example I can give you for that, really, is the piece that I played before, the Art of Fugue. Because that work has been, I think, performed by just about every combination you can think of. I mean, I haven't heard every recording by any means, but I've heard recordings by organists and harpsichordists and pianists and string quartets and string orchestras and more or less full orchestras and woodwind quartets or quintets and brass quartets and quintets. And I even heard a saxophone quartet play it once.
What?
Yeah,
really?
Yeah, rather good. And jazz singers making, what do they call it, scat sounds, you know. I can't do it, but anyway, that's the way it sounds. And none of those things really violated the music. It's just so secure structurally that it's almost impossible to do that. I think really there are two kinds of composers in this world, you know. There's the kind who says, I'm going to write the ultimate violin sonata or piano sonata or symphony or whatever. You know, your Paganinis or your Liszts or your Mahlers. And I'm going to reveal the potential of that instrument or those instruments like no one before me has ever done. Then there's the other kind of composer who says, I'm going to write a piece that will have as much meaning for the eye as for the ear. And I'm going to do that not to delight your eye, but so that when you look at it, when you contemplate it, your imagination can invent sonorities, maybe even sonorities which don't now exist, and which will help you to see the meaning of the structure as structure. And I don't really care what specific sonorities you impose upon it, as long as you achieve that end. Now, the extreme example of that, I think, would be someone like, do you know the name Carl Ruggles?
The American composer?
Yeah, who once wrote a piece called Angels, which was originally part of a symphony called Men and Angels, and I played it on the piano one time at a concert, even though he didn't recommend that one should do that, because it was originally scored for six trumpets, in fact. But I played it on the piano because what he did say about it was, he said, this piece was originally conceived for six muted trumpets, but it could be played by six clarinets, by five clarinets and a bass clarinet, or by two violins, two violas, two cellos, or by, I think he said, five violins and one cello. How about four violins and two cellos? And he said, if you transpose it down a third, you could play it on six cellos. And then, just to prove that he was no slouch in this matter and totally discriminating, he said, but no mutes if played with strings. Which is quite a marvelous thing. Now, I think that Bach was not as extreme as that. I mean, he was certainly, however, more inclined to that direction than to its opposite, and the progression of his life was absolutely in that direction, so that by the time you get to the end of his life, as you do with The Art of the Fugue, and he's writing works like that, which look inward to questions of structure, to the whole nature of processing music, instead of outward to questions of sonority and the question of public success and reception and all that. And you know, you get a totally different aspect of composition. And he's writing these pieces, moreover, at a time when the world around him was galloping off in exactly the opposite direction, you know, toward a very hedonistic kind of instrumental display, you know, the Scarlatti syndrome and all of that stuff. And so I think it's really quite an extraordinary thing that he did that against the spirit of the time. Also, you know, we talked about the mental image that one has in terms of the sonorities that we think the music implies rather than those it specifically requests. So let me play you, as a test, a little prelude that Bach wrote in the early 1720s for his son, Wilhelm Friedman, one of his sons. And you tell me what sonorities you think you hear as opposed to those that actually come out of the piano, okay?
Sounds like a cello, a pizzicato, of course.
Of course, and in the right hand?
Well, it's a kind of trio sonata, so maybe a flute or a violin or even a viola in some kind of a dialogue.
Exactly, and if you go on with it then, one could change the bowing in the left hand, the cello, whatever it is. But the point is that if you simply play that little prelude, treating the piano as a piano, it's, I think, going to sound like quite a different sort of piece.
But surely, Glenn, you're not going to argue that the piano is more suited to that music than the harpsichord or the clavichord.
No, of course not. I'm utterly indifferent to the whole question of suitability, as indeed I think Bach was. Mind you, I would be prepared to argue that in certain circumstances, in particular repertoire, the piano can get you a lot closer to Bach's conceptual notions than the harpsichord ever can. I mean, if you consider that all of the violin sonatas, all of the cello sonatas, are really trio sonatas, and that the harpsichord, the keyboard instrument, forms two-thirds of that trio. It's just unrealistic to think that the harpsichord can ever balance off against the violin, for example, in the way that the piano can. Well, we just did, of course, but you just can't hear the interplay of the textures as successfully enunciated with the harpsichord as you can with the piano, even with a cello doubling the bass line. But as far as the solo repertoire is concerned, there, I think there really is a very serious overreaction. There's a tendency to imagine that only performances on the harpsichord or the clavichord have this stamp of authenticity, you know, and I think that's just musicological overkill. And it's also a selective kind of discrimination, because one doesn't hear anybody complaining about the fact that Chopin's music is always played on modern pianos, which have about as much in common with the pianos that Chopin himself used as Chopin's pianos had in common with the harpsichord, you know? But as far as I know, there is no big back to the Pleyel movement at the moment.
Well, okay, Glenn, that's fine if you're talking about the art of fugue or the inventions or even some parts of the well-tempered clavier. But pieces like the Chromatic Fantasia, for instance, certainly could never be called absolute music by any stretch of the imagination. Mm-hmm. So it seems to me that if ever there was a piece written for a specific instrument, that's it. I mean, it's crying out for a harpsichord just as much as a Chopin nocturne cries out for a piano.
Yeah, well, I'll have to give you that, Bruno. If there's one piece written for a keyboard, it's the Chromatic Fantasia. That, I must tell you, is a first, and it's also a last. My first and last performance of any part of the Chromatic Fantasia.
Do you mean that you don't like it?
Oh, I quite cordially hate it. Back in my student days, you know, most pianists avoided all the really important Bach works like the plague, but they had to play something to open their recitals before they got to the really good stuff, like Chopin Nocturnes and Debussy Preludes, and maybe even Beethoven Sonatas. So they almost inevitably chose one of two pieces. Either it was the Italian Concerto, or it was this monstrosity. I think, to be fair to the piece, that it does give about as good a glimpse of Bach the improviser as opposed to Bach the organizer as we're probably ever going to get. I mean, the harmony wanders all over the lot. You know, it's very loosely connected by these sort of weird bits of arpeggiation. I mean, if Hitchcock had been making movies in the early 18th century, you know, Bach would have been working full-time on the Universal lot, writing background scores for sure. I mean, you see images of Peter Lorre or Vincent Price sitting at seven manual organs in haunted castles as the clock strikes midnight.
Well, what strikes me, though, is that it sounds like a piece of aleatoric music.
Oh, absolutely, because, you know, all he wrote in respect to what I just played is exactly like a jazz chart. What he wrote was... was me, you know?
Well, Glenn, you can't leave us here at midpoint.
Why not? That's what do many seventh chord do. They leave you at midpoint. You've heard one, you've heard them all. There's just more to come.
Well, nevertheless, I think you should play it to the end now.
Well, okay, but I promise you, this is going to be my absolutely last performance, okay? Now, the story thus far, when we left off, as I recall, was... You know something? That's Bach for people who do not like Bach.
All right, well, I can sense the reason behind some of your reservations concerning the chromatic fantasia. What I don't understand, though, is that why you would bracket, you know, this very loosely rhapsodic piece mm-hmm. with a work like the Italian concerto, which has that very rectangular kind of Rococo architecture.
Well, that's true. I think that both pieces, though, one could say, stand somewhat outside Bach's natural idiom, if one could call it that. I mean, neither are really contrapuntal, neither really get their ideas out of linear, stimuli, mm-hmm. one kind or another. The Italian concerto, as you say, is a well-designed, neatly blocked out bit of Georgian architecture of the kind that Handel certainly wrote all the time in England, particularly, and wrote, I think, rather more successfully, I must say. That's the kind of piece that Bach's sons would have probably liked the old man to have written all his life, but thank God he resisted the temptation most of the time anyway. And they would have liked him to do that, I suppose, because as it happens, the Italian Concerto is one of those very few pieces, really, where he quite clearly indicates certain parameters that normally he leaves up for grabs, you know.
Dynamics
and tempo, but in this case, dynamics, because he indicates very clearly 2D solo, forte, piano contrast. And then you come up against a real quandary in this piece, because when you play it on the piano natively can do things that the harpsichord cannot. It can make crescendos and it can make diminuendos, and the harpsichord, of course, cannot. It has to put out plateaus when you play it on harpsichord. So you have to then decide, okay, how much of the piano do we want in this? How much do we want to exploit and really use? And the question is not too much, because if you use too much, you then destroy the whole structure of the piece. I don't think, for example, it would be a good idea to minimize the tutti and the solo contrast by doing something like this. I mean, I think that would be really counterproductive with a contrast like that. But it's like the old string player's expression, which I'm sure you're familiar with, Bruno. Just because you paid for the whole bow, you don't have to use it. You know, just because you got a piano, you don't have to exploit its peculiar resources in that sense. On the other hand, when you come to the intensely emotional side of Bach, when you get to things like the Sarabande and the E minor partita, for example, which have an almost Wagnerian intensity, I think it's ridiculous to put straitjackets on the music, you know.
But on another line altogether, it's been very often observed in your Bach performances that you play certain movements very slowly or very quickly as the mood strikes you, it seems. And for instance, in your recording of the C-sharp major fugue, you know, mm-hmm. from the World Temple Clavier, you know, mm-hmm. pom, pom, yes. pom, pom, yes. you took an unbelievably slow tempo.
Yeah. As in...
Exactly.
You see, Bruno, my convictions in the matter are so flexible that I could, in fact, easily justify doing it exactly twice that speed. But, after all, what I'm doing is exactly what Bach himself does in many fugues, and indeed in one case in this fugue, where he treats the subject at twice the tempo in diminution or at half the tempo in augmentation. He does it here in augmentation, something like this.
Sure.
I think, mind you, it's important to say that this sort of thing is more easily applied, more safely applied to fugues, to structures that more or less stand by themselves than to other kinds of movements. I think it might be hazardous to one's musical health to try it with minuets or gigues, although even there, one has to make exceptions. There are incredible moments like that gigue in the B minor partita, which absolutely just transcends all the limits of known giguedom. Thank you. that's just a gig to surpass all gigs, you know.
But when you take a large-scale work of Bach, like the D major partita that you're going to play in a moment, do you still find that it's appropriate to treat tempo choice as a sort of random element?
No, and I'm glad you brought that up, because I really should have made that clear. No, when I said that you can double tempos and so on, I really did have in mind movements, as I said, like fugues, that more or less, or preludes or something, or even inventions that are by themselves most of the time. But I don't think it's a good idea to do that. In partitas or suites or something, I don't think there's any more excuse for doing it there, just because you can do it, than there would be excuse for doing it in a Beethoven symphony or any other, you know, big, multi-movement sort of conception.
Well, in the Beethoven symphonies, one has particular images of what each represents. One thinks of, or I at least, thinks of the fourth as the most charming, mm-hmm. and the fifth as the most motivically obsessive, and perhaps the sixth as the most tranquil and
the
mellow.
And the seventh is Beethoven's anticipation of disco music, right?
Probably, if you like. So then, do you in that way have particular associations with each of the partitas?
Yes, I do, actually. For me, the darkest, the most brooding, the most intense, the most me, is the sixth partita, the E minor, the one that I played a little bit of a moment ago. Most obviously virtuosic, I suppose, is the G major. The most charming, I think, is the first one, the B flat major. The most interesting dichotomy that he achieves in any of the partitas, dichotomy is between drama and humor, I think, comes in the second one, the C minor. And this one, the D major, this is a funny piece in a way, because despite the very heraldic opening,
You're talking about the French overture.
The French overture with its trumpets blaring and its timpani beating and all of that, despite all that obvious formality, it has a curious kind of Latin quality almost all the way throughout. There are syncopations in the Allemande, for example, that render it almost like a pavan, There are configurations in the saraband that seem almost to have been designed not even for the harpsichord, but maybe for the lute or something like that. I guess in general, I think of it as the most humane, the most benevolent of the partitas. It certainly does not have the transcendent aspirations of the E minor, and is therefore not my favorite, or the wit of the G major, or the charm of the B flat major. But it does have a very special kind of warmth, a kind of philosophical repose that I think is really quite unique.
Well, I think you should play it now so that we can all decide what it has.
Okay, why not?